everybody.
Posso falar português, mas meu português ainda está meia boca e fala muito besteira. Meu time me conhece, então eu vou switchar em inglês, falando devagar. Hoje, faz um ano e meio que estou no Brasil. So, I've been in Brazil for 1 year and a half, and I have two big surprises last year. Had a Brazilian girl that arrived last year, and also a new website. So I'm very proud of these two babies, and I will try to speak a little bit about the second one. Back a little bit from my experience, I worked 12 years on e-commerce, a bit more than five years in China, and also in France, on the largest e-commerce player of apparel. I started at Leroy Merlin about 4 years ago. In fact, 3 years working at Groupe Adeo, which is a mother company of Leroy Merlin. And I worked for 3 years all around the world to try to help this big construction company, you know, do-it-your-way company, to grow e-commerce. So it's strange because, you know, I encountered my former boss the first time, and I said, why the hell am I going to work on a construction company? Why it's been a long time I've been working only on e-commerce. And in fact, a very interesting thing about this company is they have a very clear mission. They're not here to make money directly. Of course, everyone is willing to make, but they're here to help people improve their living conditions, their living environment. And this is very, very strong in this company, in every country, and especially in Brazil. They are very focused on human being. So we have won the great place to work for us, I think the second or third year. And our salesmen, they are very focused on helping customers make their dream home come true. Not only on selling and pushing the most expensive products. So we have 16. We've been 16 years in Brazil. We have 7,000 collaborators today, 32 stores. And our main challenge on e-commerce are these ones. We have a cross-channel approach, sharing the same resource with the rest of the company. So it is really difficult for us because we don't have a big team, dedicated on e-commerce. We need to share the same resource with everyone. And they are all focused on stores. They know very well stores, but it's quite a big challenge to get resources from this. And we have more than 100,000 products on stores, today about 60,000 online, and 1,000 complex categories. And the most interesting point is not really the number of products, but it's more the categories. When I start working at Leroy, I didn't understand any of these categories. Today I take them as example when I speak with sales attendants. They know very well how to buy piso laminado. I don't even know the word in English, and all this kind of thing. And we have few product experts available, so all these experts are on the stores. So we have could be one great sales assistant in a Interlagos store. In the south of São Paulo, we have other stores in Brazil, and we have 25% of product renovation per year. So we have 100,000 products, but 25% of them we need to change onto it's a big hassle to take this information from our suppliers. We have, of course, a very low-tech supplier base, because when you buy a brick, Tijol, or something like this, the suppliers, they don't have a very nice-looking photo of your of their brick. So it's quite difficult. We need to really to get data on low-quality on pictures. Our concept is to capture knowledge from experts. We believe in people. We believe that a little bit like the other presentation, we believe really in people. So our experts are in the stores. We don't have experts on product in the internet team, and we are not going to have. What we want to do is, through automated rules, you know, make transform their knowledge into a better navigation on our website, so that we can provide a specific experience, a good experience for customers to find the right product, because very difficult to find our product. Our products are complex, you know, the air conditioning, tiling, paint, all are very difficult to choose. So we are going less on the fully automatic big data intelligence that is going, you know, very popular today through low cost of cloud. We want to provide a more human created algorithm, more human touch on our website. But of course, we need a maximum efficiency because we don't have 100 people to, you know, to digit products every day. So we need to be very efficient on it on the web. A short story. So when I arrived at the beginning of 2013, with a big welcome of our team, I discovered a website that already had quite an important traffic. But at the same time, you know, almost once a week, we had outage. We have a lot of bugs. Site was very slow. The search didn't function very well. So for the first months, I worked to find a team. So it took some time to find a team. The team was not very big, but it took a lot of time. I spent a lot of time, you know, LinkedIn on social networks to find the right persons. I did a lot of tests to find the right team. And after a few months, you know, I begin to bring in the company a few of our team, which I'm very proud of working with today. And 6 months later, a little bit less than a baby, came out the first version of our website. Then 6 months later, the second one, fully responsive, and with our dynamic rules embedded on this website. Today, we're not yet e-commerce. We're working hard on the cross-channel concept. So we have to work together with stores. We have to work together with our information system. Our company don't want to set up a different business for e-commerce. Don't want to compete with stores. We want to create the same, you know, the same infrastructure on a step by step to do really full cross-channel. That's our challenge. Our success for 2013, a big success for our catalog team, product team. We multiply by 3 our catalog offering, reaching 60,000 products in 1 year. It's quite impressive. We are now the largest online catalog in Brazil for home segment. We have 70% of our product range cleaned in 1.5 years. And when you know our category of products, you don't believe the work it is. It's data is a big, big mess for us. We have product, we have hardware. We have, when I say hardware, is a screw. You know, we have air conditioning. We have a lot of very complex product to get data on. This is a huge work. Usability. We have an online survey, a little survey, very simple. Every 1,000 visitors display the survey, and you just ask how happy you are with the website. And we are consistently above 8.5 out of 10 on this survey. We are also one of the first big responsive websites in Brazil. And we scored in June 2014, number one of between all our competitors on 15 out of 16 items on the survey. So I'm very, very proud of the work of my team. And here's our traffic results, multiplied by 5 in 1.5 years. We had a healthy organic growth. We're working very well on SEO, so that we didn't change, our investment on pay is low and didn't change month by month. It's the same for about 1.5 years. Today, about 2 months ago, we became the number one in traffic on home centers and decoration pure players. On at the group level, we were the number 6 company in Brazil in the world in terms of traffic, and we are now number 2. So just let's introduce a little bit the point of my presentation. Before the 20s, you know, the shopping was like this. You had a guy, a sales assistant, sales vendor, behind the counter. And this guy, you had to ask him to bring product for you. You know, customers were waiting in queue to get their product. And before the 20s, started in the US and then after in Europe and Brazil, a new revolution. This revolution was not e-commerce yet. It was self-service. So people, they could get their product by themselves without even asking for the salespeople. So that's what they do. You don't need to ask for a beer. Just take the beer and go away. And then, you know, we are a segment on the market that grew in size of products and reached an unbelievable number of products. This is Carrefour, 25,000 square meter, over 200,000 SKU. It was in the 70s. I believe all of you know the long tail. I'm a guy of internet, so I didn't know that long tail started way before the e-commerce. And it's quite interesting because, you know, and this image is quite impressive. And today, I like this image too because I hate, you know, going in these large superstores because I always struggle to find my products. And there is a lot of similar products. You spend hours of choosing a simple product. So is it really profitable for customers? That's a question they have been, the retail has been asking. Carrefour downsized this large store I showed you by 6,000 square meter in 2008. To improve profitability. Tesco in England find his megastores too big, and so they sell some part of the megastore because they cannot downsize, they're not internet, they're physical. So they decide to sell, you know, part of their space to restaurants, gyms, or something like this to make more profit. On Walmart US, it's 2014, it's recent, they decide to invest massively on small stores because small stores make more money. Interesting when we just saw the last presentation. And I wish them a lot of success because I think it's the right model. Another study in 2010 by Booz & Co. It's one of the leading consulting on strategy for retail. They discovered on a leading grocery retailer, 25% of its stocked item account for almost, guess, 100% of their profits. So the question is, what's the point? You know, what's the point to grow your catalog? This is the origin of merchandising. As you know, since the 70s, people they want to maximize profitability per square meter because they increase their store too much. So they provide to customers the same thing, the same product, and people don't really choose. So what American Marketing Association is saying is, merchandising is helping the customer select the right product at the right place and at the right time. Of course, in right quantities on the right place, which I won't be speaking today. So at the right product, at the right place, and at the right time. Here is some of the efforts they are doing. Here's a picture, I think it's Interlagos. You see the ambiental image, the decorations they did, and then the upper place of the store to inspire more our clients, to give them, you know, to make them want to buy. Another thing in Carrefour, when you see the old store, you know, with massive amount of products, they changed. So they reduced drastically the number of products in beauty, and they, in France, like they set up in another way, more attractive to customer. Another on wine also, that you can see in Brazil. So what about the web? We're speaking about retail, but what about the web? Few profitable e-commerce players yet. Everybody is focused on growth. Profitability, it will come later, probably. Increasing catalog size. Now Amazon has about 200 millions of products. It's amazing. I worked on Alibaba also, Taobao in China. It's even worse. And everybody wants to launch marketplace today. It becomes my boss 2 years ago said, "Hey, Gaetan, why don't we launch a marketplace and so on in France or in other country? Why not? But we have to think really of the value. If everybody is doing marketplace, selling a huge quantity of product, then be like this, exactly like this, 30 years ago. 30 years, you know, I was 5 years old, and I don't want to come back. And here is Amazon, a screenshot I took yesterday. You know, the photo I showed to you, the photo right before was one on shampoo. Guess how many shampoo has Amazon to sell yesterday? 39,000 shampoo. Say, it's a big market, but, well, so what? 400 pages. Well. So web merchandising is about catalog organization, is about search, and is about fine-tuning your page. I'll speak about these three different aspects. Also, the last one, which is quite interesting, and we are just beginning on this fourth part, is visual merchandising. Let's start about the first catalog organization. Contents and products. Why contents? Contents, they are video. Video, they are text. We try, you know, to do 1% of the job of a sales attendant. So we do some videos of our best sales attendant that know the product. And they try to just tell a little bit of how they will tell customer how to choose products. So we want to associate these contents, these videos, closely related to our products. Multi-exposition of categories, multiple depth classification, and multi-tree arborescence. I will speak about all these subjects. So let's start the first one. Our content approach is through automated rules. Bring context to content. Think contents here. You know, we are on our big menu, now we are on climatization and ventilation. And then we have aquesador de agua, on ventilators, air conditioning. So we bring generic subjects related to this top level category. And once we click on air conditioning, then our contents, they are all in context. Then when we click on air conditioner split, I don't know if you know what is an air conditioner split, I discovered. Then we bring content to help you select your air conditioner split. So we try to really bring closely the advice from a real, it's a real guy that speaks on the video, it's one of our salesmen, it's one of the best. He knows much more on air conditioner split than any people of my team, including me. And another way, finally, we do some relations between products and content. What we believe is content, pictures is content, video is content, article is content, everything is content except products. Okay, so here we did with something interesting. We use a tool a little bit like Facebook tagging. So our team, when they receive from a merchandising or for a communication a nice picture, they take this nice picture, and then they just click where we have products, and they select on our system the product corresponding. It's a way to inspire and to get ideas to our client, because we want to help client to choose product, but also to have ideas about what he can do with the product, with our product. Let's go to the second topic, multi-exposition of categories. When I start working about 4 years ago in France, I visited a lot of stores, and sometimes you can't find a product because you have in mind, for example, you want to go buying a product, torneiras. I know the word in Portuguese. So you want to buy a tornera, and you have in mind that you are in a project of kitchen. So you are going in the kitchen section, you go on the store and you ask, you know, where is the kitchen section? And then you go walk in the store and you find just only one product because it's cross-selling, and they decided to put a tornera close to the kitchen section. And then you go out of the store saying, oh, no, Leroy Merlin doesn't have any choice in Tornelas. But in fact, the store, he decided to put all the Tornelas in the bathroom section. Because it takes a lot of place and you have to make choice because we have physical walls, so we cannot, you know, place 300 or 500 Tornelas in both sections. So here what we do in the internet is we don't have to have the same constraint. You can find, for example, ventilators on the illumination side because in Brazil they have a light at the top, so sometimes people look at them on this segment. And also you can find the same, you know, arborescence in climatization. We have a lot of this because people, you know, they are saying go on buy a good search engine. Because your navigation, nobody will buy from your navigation because clients are lost. They don't transform. They don't buy through your navigation. They buy much better on the web, on the search engine. But if you work really well on your navigation, people will find because there is always 60 or 70% of the people walking on the stores. On online, it's the same thing. Even the salesman of a big search engine, they will say that there is about 40% of people looking online, looking on the search engine. So the rest is navigating on the website. So let's speak a little bit of multiple depth classification. Our products are complex. We have 1,000 categories. It's huge. It's not the number of products, it's the number of different categories. We have categories that are very deep. Ferrage and Sla is very deep. It's a very complex category. There are a lot of levels. So we go from ferrage to fixation. From fixation to parafusos, and then after you can suggest the customer what he really wants. Is it for metal? Is it for madera? So we try also a little bit to help, like if it was a salesman, you know, the vendor, he will ask the customer, okay, why do you want to buy this? And we take a little bit of his knowledge on the website. Another case on a very flat navigation. So we are here on pisos en revestimentos. There is pedras naturais. When you click here, it's a very flat, you know, organization catalog, flooring. So you arrive directly on the segment. You don't need to do the same number of paths to get there. The last one, it's a new experiment we did. We launched it about I think 3 weeks ago. Our website, the new version of our website, it came with a concept we call multi-tree. In fact, we want to provide also to our consumer, to our visitors, different ways to navigate, you know, through the website. I showed you the main menu, organizing very well, tending to organize as much as possible our products into categories, departments, subcategories, everything. But why could we could do also by style. You know, we could do for professionals, we could do by projects, we could do by brands, do landing page for SEO. And we build different catalogs, separated catalogs, which completely different ways to organize our products. So the first, you know, test we did a few weeks ago is on navigation by style. We had more and more pictures, you know, these decorative pictures. And these decorative pictures, we wanted to organize them by room. Because some of our clients, most of them, they have on their mind a project. They don't come to Leroy Merlin to just buy products. They come because they want to have a project, they're working on a project, and they want to buy products for their project. So here we have a two-level organization. The first level is by room, you know, bañeros, cuisines, and so on. And the second level is by style. With our purchasing central, we are trying to work on categorizing products by style. And this is the first experiment. We'll try to push a little bit harder after. So I finished the first part on organizing your catalog, what we are doing up to today. And I'll go through another part, which I believe is very related to the first one. That's why place it number two, is search analyzing. I really believe that people navigate on the website. They're not either navigate, either search. They begin by navigating, then they switch to search, then they switch to browsing. And we believe also that the work of our team, you know, our human being, all the employees of Leroy Merlin, is much better than the automated algorithm, even if we use a new software that we believe are very good. So all the time they dedicate to organize you know, each categories, more than 1,000 categories, to divide, you know, by you know, for metal, for wood, for all the use. We try to send these visitors from the search engine directly to well-organized categories, not just to a bunch of results that our search engine just give you, because there is a description of the product with a certain name. So we feel better catalog organization, better facets, better characteristics, better product data is giving a feedback to better search experience. I'll show you how. We have the first part is our quick search. The suggestion we provide to our consumers are based in two different things. All the categories, more than 1,000 we have, we index them. Most of our customers, they don't know exactly how to the detailed product they want. So instead of just, you know, pushing products, like most of the market is doing, as our catalog is complex and people don't know really what they want in the detail, we suggest parafusos, parafusadere. And when they click on it, they arrive directly on the well-organized, clean category done by the product team. So it's a feedback loop. Here they arrive in this category, it's not a bunch of results. And here we advise the customer, okay, what kind of parafuse do you want? What kind of parafuse do you want? They don't know yet. And then arrive here, it's a bit of help for them to make the right choice. So the second technique we use are shortcuts. When you digit, when you type on our search engine, a word that is really similar to one of our category, you arrive direct on the category. We don't give this word to the search engine. We prefer human beings that automated search engine results. So you go directly by on the well-organized category here. We funnel and guide visitors through the catalog. So how it works? We have a big database where we put categories, products, content, customer data, and we have a search engine tightly coupled together with this database. Each product, we store products and categories, are indexed on the search engine. And then all this system throw facets on search results. Facets are the filters you find on the left, and I will be speaking about facets right now, on the micro-merchandising. So facets on cross-upsell. Well, so first advice, if you want to have to work well with your facets, you have a huge work on working on data. The product team knows it very well. We have a discussion a few days ago about how to work on colors. I took an example of a site I've seen in shoe stock. Now we have the same problem at Leroy Merlin. A few days ago, I think Danny and Marie asked me, okay, we have more than 50 different colors. And all of your suppliers have their own names. You know, the names they put here, neutro, amarelo, marino, beige, khaki. How do you do the customer can, you have one product in each of them, because all of these words, they are from the suppliers. And also, the way you order your facet is important. For example, Zappos in US, they always put the size first. And I hate when I spend 20 or 50 minutes, you know, to look for a nice model of shoes, and then I realize that there is no stock in 44. Visual facets. When it's hard to express, use visual facets. I don't know if some of you know Chinese, but even in French, I don't know how to, you know, to call these shoes. I'm not a woman, but so Another nice thing, so last year, Amazon, they changed a little bit their facets, and they had a very smart drawing on these facets. Nobody knows how to call this thing, even in English or in French. Another thing, customer-oriented facets. Here we are on our brothers' companies. They do a better job than us because they are able to taking the advice of a sales attendant in the store. Customers, when they go in the store, they want to buy a grass mower. And the sales attendant say, what's the size of your garden? And they don't say, what's the power you want? They don't say, what's the altura da corte? So, the suppliers, they will never give you the number of square meter adapted for, because they will say, oh, you can use my grass mower for any size. You know, it take a little bit of time, but you can achieve it. So this is a work you have to do by rules or by working closely with your team to see what kind of value you can bring. Well, let's go to the third subject, cross and upselling. This is a photo I took in China. It's quite funny. What kind of product you think is related to this those batteries? So, it's big data automation. So we have four ways to do cross and upsell. Handpicked cross-selling, big data, rule-based semi-automatic, an advanced case that we'll show you later. All of them are good. But then you need to choose them, which one you use for different kind of products. Because each category of product work differently. So here we have I don't know how to say it, but it's a brand specialized in kitchen. Kitchens, they don't have hundreds of products, thousands of products. They have a limited range of products. So look how they select, you know, their product. They probably do it handpicked, and they're right. Because they have a low range of products. Here on Netflix, it's quite interesting because Netflix is one of the most nice catalog to use big data, because they have very homogeneous catalogs. They sell they have films. So film is one category of product. They have huge, you know, products, huge quantity of product inside. So here, affinity analysis is working very well, and you see that the beginning is it's pretty good job. Orange is the New Black, Dr. House. But, it's quite difficult to fine-tune. It's a nice job, but if it were a different kind of product, a more strict product, then it will be more difficult. I'll take an example of what we are beginning to do at Leroy Merlin with our rule-based cross-selling, is we have the relationship we have on our products is more a strong relationship. Because especially on complementary products, we cannot do mistake. Because if we want if we sell the wrong product, then our customer won't be very happy of us. So here we have a simple rule with display the product from the same voltage, similar power, and with a cable. We have only four displaying on this product. The most interesting is for complementary products, because drill bits, you know, they have to fit inside the driller. And there is two different mechanisms. And if you just suggest what other people viewed, then it'll make unhappy customers. An advanced case, which is not very beautiful, but it's very smart, is done by a Brazilian website called Madeira Madeira. So you see, you can digit the number of square meter you want on your room. You want to buy flooring. So you buy by square meter instead of by box. And then you click on the big button, Quero Comprar. And it suggests complementary product you will need to do your project. And one good thing is to see is there is a small thing in blue here is a number 4. And this number 4 to appear is very smart. Because they don't only suggest what product you may be interested in, They suggest the right quantity you will need to do your project. So you won't have to go two or three times at the store to buy something. Bon, and most finishing, this is the fourth visual merchandising. Visual merchandising, we almost didn't start yet, but we're on the way, and in a few months we'll launch some things. So I believe, I did a mistake, but I said as part, I spoke about a little bit about responsive design, because we launched responsive design 2 months ago, so it's fresh, and we did four breakpoints. We added a breakpoint for big screen, because of the use inside stores, and also because people have more, you know, more and more qualitative screen. And it's quite interesting because we have a very positive effect on mobile traffic, of course, and we have a better use of available screen. So I came to have a new concept. We all look at on our statistics, on our KPI, about page per visit. Page per visit is almost bullshit, because you can put anything. You can put 30 products in your page per visit, 10 products on a page. It depends on how you build your website, you know. But a good information should be page per screen. You know, product, the number of products you can put in the same screen. So our learnings is that you need to optimize image size for mobile. You cannot simply just adapt your site so that it can fit in a mobile. You have to provide a bigger picture when you are in a bigger breakpoint, on a smaller one when you're on mobile. Otherwise, you will wait until a lot of time. Standardize all your interfaces. If you have four different versions of each page to maintain, especially with a small team, it's impossible. So you have to standardize every bit of your interface on, we call it Pattern Lab. And we work on, you know, parts of interface instead of working on pages. And we need to test on real machine because of touchscreen too. So this is the number of products we can put on the same screen, on one screen, after the responsive change. And this, for example, Home Depot is putting four products. So if our challenge on merchandising is to show more products to our customer, it's quite important. Another thing is differentiated merchandising. In stores, they have started to do it the past 20 years. When you go in big retail store, you see each category is different. Each category is different. They don't have the same pattern you have everywhere in the web. Today, when you go in Amazon, you're on Taobao, you go on any of the big retailer, you know, big pure player online, you see the same shit. So I took the example of our website, because I don't want to, we are proud of our website, but look at our website for kitchen. Here is a specialist in kitchen in Belgium, small site, you know, of a company dedicated at selling kitchen. Look at our website, again, I'm proud of it, but just to selling painting. This is a souvenir, I think it's one of the leading company in Brazil. Look at our website selling hardware. And look at this website, which I love, from US, which more than 550 products on the hardest kind of products you can imagine. So we have a lot of work to do. And I believe we are at the same level of what retail was about 20 years ago on this. We have the same page in everything. So speaking a little bit of our organization, we have 30 people in our team. Our team is divided in two. One is a product team working in another area, closely to inside the supply, the purchasing central team. And we have half of the team, which is e-business, web technology, marketing team. So we work in agile, and with a big touch of do-it-yourself. We don't leave, if we can do it, then we do it directly. Hoppa. Just finished with a small video of when we launched the first version of our website. It was about 2 or 3 of in the morning.
Cache limpado ou
limpa o cache?
Mas cadê o cache? Você vai limpar o cache, vai. Tá sujo, tá sujo. Você vai limpar o cache, vai ganhar o meu celular que vai levar de milhão?
Limpou lá. Então abre o meu, vamos ver.
Tava no botão aqui, só dá um clique.
Coisa os dedos.
Porque, cara, o IE tem um cache engraçado, cara.
Eu posso dar um update na instância aqui.
Eu acho que é melhor. É possível, muda até de sistema operacional, já bota no XP. Já.
Você explodiu.
Você joga na mesma.
É verdade.
Às vezes o browser tech joga na mesma.
Response time. Mas vamos mudar a instância do browser stack.
Eu uso o browser stack.
O browser stack está mudando a instância. Ainda não está atualizando. Vai atualizar. Claro. Atualizou, oi. Está atualizado.
It was 3 in the morning.
Depois vou botar no YouTube. Là-bas.
Aí,
E8. Não dá para azul.
Tá chamando gambeta aqui das
fotos. So just 1 minute. It was a very nice time, about 2 in the morning. People really passionate. And just a few people, a small team, you know, can do it if they're really passionate and they like it. So thank you very much.
Thank you guys.